Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Vanished Hero, the life, war, and mysterious disappearance of America's World War II Strafing King, by J.A. Stout. Narrated by Joe Barrett. Introduction. I'll see you when I get back. The Jeep squeaked to a stop. The pilot sat motionless in the passenger seat and stared straight ahead, drawing slow, weary breaths. All at once he grunted, sat upright, grabbed his flying gear, and stepped onto the damp ground. The Jeep immediately crunched into gear and scooted away as he started toward his aircraft. Block letters across the sleek fighter's nose marked it as Katie Did. It was named after his wife, Catherine. Next to the name, a voluptuous green caricature of a winged katydid struck a pose. Bare-breasted, long-legged, and high-heeled, the implausible but undeniably sexy figure conveyed a distinctly flirtatious look. A crew chief fussed with a balky set of fasteners on the P-51's underside. The pilot watched him for a moment before moving unhurriedly around the aircraft to confirm that everything was as it should be. Satisfied, he leaned over and checked once more on the enlisted man. A brisk English breeze chilled the morning, and the pilot stood upright and zipped his jacket against it. He reached for his leather helmet and pulled it on. After so many months of combat, it was stiff with dried sweat and it stank, but the snugness of it was nevertheless familiar and comforting. He pulled the goggles that were fastened to the helmet over his eyes to make certain they were clean. Through them, across the airfield, he saw dozens of other pilots and ground crews readying for the day's mission. He lifted the goggles back onto his helmet, stepped onto the fighter's left wing, and up to the cockpit. There he grabbed the top of the windscreen, stepped over the canopy sill, and eased his athletic frame down into the seat. A quick glance at the myriad gauges, switches, knobs, and levers confirmed to him that the aircraft was ready to start. He waited for a moment for the crew chief to come out from under the airplane to help him with the buckles and straps of his parachute. The man didn't appear, and the pilot tired of waiting. He sighed and called out, "Sergeant! Sergeant, come help me with my parachute!" The crew chief, Don Downs, was still busy with the fasteners. "If you can't put on the goddamn chute, you can't fly the plane!" he shouted. The pilot's request changed to a demand. "Sergeant! Come up here and help me with my parachute!" Exasperated, Downs scrabbled out from under the P-51. His eyes widened when he looked up to the cockpit. Rather than a fresh-faced, shave-tailed lieutenant, he discovered that the pilot wore oak leaves as big as basketballs and packed a .45-caliber pistol in a shoulder harness. The man to whom he had just mouthed off was the 55th Fighter Group's commander, Lieutenant Colonel Elwyn G. Righetti. Righetti, a celebrated ace, was in charge of not only the 55th and its airfield at Wormingford, but virtually everything and everyone on it, including Downs. Downs leapt onto the wing and apologized as he bent over and helped his commander settle into the cockpit. Finished, he stood upright. Righetti fixed him with a look that left no doubt that his displeasure had not passed. "I'll see you when I get back." The deep-throated thrum of the P-51's engine vibrated the airframe with a gentle tremble that made it feel as if it were a living thing. Righetti loved the Mustang, and especially liked how it seemed to wrap itself around him, as if it were a bespoke suit, custom-tailored by artisans. No other aircraft had cradled him so perfectly, and there was no other fighter in the world he wanted to fly. Aside from the feel of it, the gas and oil and metal reek of the muscular little fighter comprised a unique perfume, and no flying machine could match its sleek good looks, a striking balance of purposeful power and aerodynamic efficiency. Righetti looked across the airfield where dozens of other P-51s also sat idling. They waited for his lead. Some of the fighters, like his own silvery aircraft, wore scarcely any paint at all. Their propeller spinners were circled with green and yellow stripes, and the fronts of their engine cowlings wore similarly colored checkered bands. These were identification markings specific to the 55th, but a few of the aircraft were partially painted with a sweeping olive drab pattern that covered the wings and ran back from the engine cowling, and then stretched down the top of the fuselage to the empennage. The unsanctioned scheme accented the aircraft's trim lines and was unique to the 55th. The tails of a few of the Mustangs wore the profile of a rearing stallion on their rudders. Righetti checked his wristwatch against the slip of paper strapped to his knee. It was marked with important particulars about the day's mission, such as the takeoff and rendezvous times, the route, the markings of the bomber units that were to be escorted, and the expected weather, among other important information. The slip was marked with the date, April 17, 1945. It was his 30th birthday, and he reflected for a moment on his wife and young daughter. They would be asleep now, at home near San Luis Obispo, on the ranch where he had been born and raised. The 55th was assigned to escort B-17s of the 8th Air Force's 3rd Air Division across targets in Dresden, not far from Germany's border with Czechoslovakia. In fact, the war was nearly over, and there was little promise of air combat, as the Allies had beaten the German Air Force, the Luftwaffe, nearly out of existence. Indeed, the Nazis were expected to surrender or be completely overrun during the next few weeks. It was a time frame that neatly corresponded with the end of Righetti's combat tour, as he had to fly only a few more missions before reaching the 300 combat hours required to rotate back to the States. Regardless, he had been growing increasingly exhausted and was ready for it all to be over. Righetti nodded at Downs, who, careful to stay away from the spinning propeller, ran under the aircraft and dragged the wheel chocks clear. Checking ahead and behind him, Righetti released the fighter's brakes, added power, and rolled from the hard stand onto the airfield's perimeter track. He returned the salute that Downs threw at him and started for the runway. The P-51's nose blocked his view forward, and Righetti stepped on one rudder pedal then the other, fishtailing the little fighter back and forth across the track so that he could better see what was in front of him. Other aircraft left their hard stands, likewise weaving, as they fell into a long, snaking line behind him. Crew chiefs, armorers, and other support personnel held tightly to their hats and shielded their eyes against the blast of propeller-blown dust and debris. Nearing the runway, Righetti finished his takeoff checks and cranked the canopy closed. The growl of his engine changed timbre to a muted rumble. Behind him, he saw the three squadrons that made up the 55th, the 38th, the 338th, and the 343rd, readying for takeoff. He checked his wristwatch once more and watched Paul Reeves and his wingman pull past him and onto the runway. Reeves was flying his last mission. "At the briefing, Righetti called me aside," said Reeves, "and told me that I would lead the group, form it, and take it to enemy territory, and at that point he would assume the lead and I was to return to base. He pointed out that we had lost too many guys on their last scheduled mission and that we were not going to lose any more. It seemed like a very thoughtful and considerate thing." A few seconds passed, and a flare arced skyward from the control tower. The flagman posted at the edge of the runway pointed at Reeves's ship and whipped his flag over his head with a dramatic flourish. Reeves and his wingman advanced their engines and started down the runway together. The prop wash from the two aircraft rocked Righetti's fighter as he pushed up his own throttle and rolled onto the runway. Carol Henry, Righetti's wingman, taxied into position next to Katydid, raised a thumb and flashed a smile. The rumble of Katydid's engine grew into a popping roar as Righetti eased the throttle forward. At the same time, he stepped on the right rudder pedal to counter the powerful torque that tried to swing the aircraft left and off the runway. More power produced more torque, but Righetti reflexively kept it under control, and soon he and Henry were accelerating down the runway. At just more than 100 miles an hour, the tails of the two aircraft lifted clear of the ground, and seconds later they were airborne. Righetti and Henry raised their landing gear simultaneously and climbed straight ahead after Paul Reeves. Behind them, the group's other aircraft chased each other down the runway and into the sky. As the distance between him and the airfield grew, they looked to Righetti like a long stream of silvery green minnows. Several miles out, he followed Reeves and his wingman into a gentle turn back toward the airfield as the last elements of the group got airborne and joined the formation in three distinct squadrons. Righetti, with Reeves, headed the 338th, while the 38th and 343rd followed in trail. With the airfield a few miles ahead, the pilots tightened the formation and accelerated in a gentle descent. This low pass over the airfield not only made it easy for the 55th to pick up an exact heading from Wormingford to the first point on the assigned route, but more importantly, it was a morale booster for the men who maintained the aircraft and otherwise made it possible for the group to fly. Those same men squinted into the sky as the 55th's aircraft roared overhead. The noise from so many powerful engines rattled their chests and thundered for miles across the East Anglian countryside. Don Downs was among those men. As the last of the group's P-51s passed and started a climb to the east, he set off to find his boss. He wanted to take a 3-day furlough, starting immediately. Near Freiburg, over eastern Germany, Righetti leaned forward and peered past his gun sight and through the aircraft's windscreen. Straight ahead at 24,000 feet, he spotted a series of specks at the head of a great carpet of white, fluffy contrails. The specks were nearly indistinguishable from the tiny nicks and bug carcasses and motes of dirt that spotted his windscreen, but they grew in size as he led the 55th closer. Finally, he recognized the bright white squares that were painted on the tails of each of the big B-17s. The squares marked them as 3rd Air Division bombers. The 55th had made the rendezvous a few minutes early, but he suspected that the bomber crews wouldn't mind. In truth, however, the early rendezvous probably wouldn't make much difference, as it was doubtful that the much-beleaguered Luftwaffe would make an appearance. Still, regardless of whether the enemy showed or not, Righetti and his fighter group had a job to do. He checked to see the 38th and the 343rd separate from him and the rest of the 338th, to take up their assigned positions. Spread apart, the 55th's 3 squadrons, flying a few thousand feet above the bomber stream, could provide better coverage than if they stayed together in one huge, unwieldy formation. At the same time, Reeves's aircraft arced up and away toward Wormingford. Righetti watched a 2nd aircraft follow Reeves. He knew this was Frank Burtzel, who, like Reeves, was flying his last mission. Burtzel had arrived in England with the 55th in September 1943 and completed one combat tour flying P-38s before the group made its transition to the P-51 during July 1944. "I really liked and respected Righetti," Burtzel said. "He might have saved my life during that last mission. We had lost 2 other guys during the previous week who were also flying their last missions. Righetti didn't want to see that same thing happen, so he ordered me to go home as soon as we rendezvoused with the bombers." Through the occasional breaks in the clouds below, Righetti checked his chart against his position over the ground and his fuel gauge. Likewise, he glanced at his engine instruments every minute or so. A sour engine so deep over enemy territory was no small matter. And, as did every other pilot in the 55th, he scanned the sky for enemy fighters. But he gave no thought to the actual act of flying his aircraft. After so many years of experience, his hands and feet directed it automatically. The mission was a grueling one, not because of enemy action, but simply because, at more than 5 hours, it was so long. Protracted flight at high altitudes in an unpressurized cockpit was exhausting. It numbed the senses, and the bitter cold often overpowered the cockpit heating system and worked its way through the layers of clothing that the men wore. At a minimum, the missions were boring and frigid. At their worst, when beset by enemy fighters in heavy flak, they were terrifying. On this particular mission, up to that point, it was the former. Bored and cold, Righetti and the rest of the 55th took the bombers across the target and started them on their way back to England. Below them, under attack by more than 1,000 bombers, Dresden citizens were anything but bored and cold. The bombs bounced and burned the rubble that their city had already become after a number of previous raids. Those raids killed more than 20,000. On this day, more than 500 additional civilians were killed. The responsibility for escorting the bombers was passed to another fighter group on schedule, and the 55th's individual squadrons descended to look for targets of opportunity. The weather through the entire region was poor, and heavy cloud cover and haze made formation keeping difficult. Consequently, the men tightened their formations as they dropped through the clouds. Righetti, with Henry still on his wing, took the 338th down to just a few thousand feet and trolled the area to the north and west of Dresden. The pilots looked for whatever merited killing, aircraft, trucks, troops, trains, or anything else that might be useful to the Germans. As they motored through the poor visibility, calls over the radio made it apparent that other elements of the 55th were heavily engaged with enemy fighters. There is little doubt that this information sharpened Righetti's outlook. Competitive and chronically keen for a fight, there were few missions during which he didn't fire his guns. He spotted an airfield near the town of Riesa, about 20 miles northwest of Dresden. There were a number of enemy aircraft parked at various points around the airfield, and Righetti ordered the flight to stay at altitude while he dropped down to check for anti-aircraft fire. Henry asked for and received permission to follow him. "He wanted me to stay up there with the other guys," Henry said, "but when I requested, he let me go." Righetti dove almost to the ground and leveled off to set up for a firing run from the east. He cranked in a touch of rudder trim to center the ball in the fluid-filled tube of his turn and bank indicator. An aircraft that was out of trim sprayed bullets everywhere but where they were aimed. Next, he twisted the gun sight's rheostat to adjust the brightness of the aiming pipper that was projected onto its small glass plate. Too bright, and it would wash out whatever he aimed at. Too dim, and he couldn't see where Katydid's guns were pointed. Finally, he checked that his gun switch was set to guns, sight, and camera. With Henry on his wing, Righetti spotted an ME-109 parked at the edge of the airfield. He banked slightly left and lowered the aircraft's nose until the gun sight's pipper rested on the fuselage just below the canopy. He held it there with slight forward pressure on the control stick as Katydid swiftly closed the range. Righetti squeezed the trigger at the front of his control stick. The 6 50-caliber machine guns, 3 in each wing, responded with a bucking roar that actually slowed his aircraft. Each of the guns sent armor-piercing projectiles toward the enemy fighter at a rate of 800 rounds per minute. Righetti released the trigger after only a couple of seconds. An instant passed before great clots of earth and grass erupted from the ground around the German fighter. The rounds which found their mark twinkled and flashed and tore pieces from the ME-109 before turning it into a fireball just as Righetti passed overhead. He looked up and immediately caught sight of an FW-190 approaching to land. Henry was closer to the enemy aircraft than he was, and Righetti called out his position and told Henry, "Go get it." "He had eyes like an eagle," Henry said. "I didn't see it." A few seconds of frantic searching later, Henry spotted the enemy aircraft and made a quick heading correction. Slow as he was, and with his landing gear extended, the German fighter pilot was virtually helpless. Henry framed the FW-190 in his gun sight, fired his guns, and watched his rounds knock the hapless German out of the sky. "I killed him, I guess, because he just hit the runway and rolled over. The plane was on fire when he hit the ground." Righetti saw the German aircraft crash in flames. He wrenched his own ship around in a sequence of sharp treetop-level turns, while enemy gun crews, fully alert now, tried to shoot him down. Puffs of light anti-aircraft fire burst around him as he lined up for another run. More anti-aircraft fire crisscrossed his flight path, and smoke from the aircraft he and Henry had already set ablaze drifted skyward. Notwithstanding the efforts of the German gun crews, Righetti set several more aircraft afire. This wasn't the artful, twisting aerial ballet that was air-to-air combat. That sort of fighting demanded superb gunnery and a deft touch on the controls. Indeed, the skill required to cause a stream of bullets fired from an aircraft moving in three dimensions to arrive at the exact same point in the sky and at the exact same instant as another aircraft moving in those same three dimensions was not easily acquired. Very few pilots were good at it. Righetti was one of them, and had proven it during the previous months by single-handedly downing 7 German aircraft. But strafing parked aircraft was different. The targets didn't move, and consequently the physics necessary to achieve a satisfactory firing solution were relatively simple. A pilot only had to hold his aircraft steady and put the gun sight's pipper on the target until he flew into range. Then, just a few seconds on the trigger delivered enough rounds to tear any aircraft apart. But it took big guts. Indeed, there was no more dangerous mission for a fighter pilot. This was a fact borne out by the records, as many more fighters over Europe were lost to ground fire than to enemy fighters. This was primarily because an aircraft flying a straight, predictable flight path low to the ground was vulnerable to the batteries of guns that typically protected important targets. The enemy gunners needed only to shoot far enough ahead of an attacking aircraft to stand a reasonable chance of hitting it. Or, together with other gun crews, they could simply create a curtain of fire through which an aircraft had to fly. These types of concentrated barrages became especially deadly as the Germans retreated into an ever-shrinking area and brought their anti-aircraft guns with them. Indeed, as the war drew to an end, the concentration of anti-aircraft guns on the Luftwaffe's remaining airfields was devastating. Righetti and Henry made their attacks at speeds that were considerably less than what their aircraft were capable of flying. "If you flew too fast, you didn't have time to see anything," Henry said. But slower speeds made them more vulnerable. So did making repeated passes against a well-defended airfield. It was a practice that went against common sense and tactical dictums, but it was perfectly consistent with Righetti's outsized ferocity in the face of enemy fire. Indeed, by the time he started his third run, the gun crews at Riza were fully ready. He picked out another enemy aircraft, lowered the nose of his aircraft, and held it down. Finally in range, he squeezed the trigger and saw his bullets arc over the airfield and into the German fighter. An instant later, Righetti heard a loud bang and felt Katydid shudder. Don Downs finished packing his bag. It was a cinch that he'd be off the base before Righetti landed back at Wormingford. I now have cancer. I love to hear from people who have read my books. Truly, we history writers never get the attention we think we deserve. Who does? So naturally, I was gratified upon reading the first line of the email. I am a big fan of your outstanding work on USAAF fighter pilots, and have read and reread your books, Fighter Group, and The Men Who Killed the Luftwaffe. And then the bombshell. I now have cancer, and want to find someone to whom I can donate my library and research archive. This admirer I didn't know, Tony Meldahl, was dying. An Army veteran and German linguist, he was a researcher rather than a writer, and had worked with renowned authors Iris Chang and Joe Galloway. And for more than two decades, he had been fascinated with the Elwyn Righetti story. He had conducted interviews, collected stacks of obscure books, translated dozens of documents, collaborated with aviation experts around the world, and visited with the Righetti family. The products of all those efforts were boxed into an enormous stack of cartons and additionally captured on two massive hard drives. And although he had once planned to write a book on Righetti, he now wanted to give the material he had collected to me. My first choice is you. Your depth of understanding, quality of research, and extraordinary writing skills make you, in my opinion, the best writer in this field. I feel you have the right stuff to write a mainstream book about Righetti on par with Galloway's We Were Soldiers Once and Young. I felt simultaneously prideful and guilty. Such praise! But life was leaving Tony, and there was little hope that he would see his dream of a Righetti biography realized. Still, I reminded myself to be wary of gift horses. I didn't know Tony, and wasn't exactly certain what he wanted. I responded very tentatively, but with compassion for a dying man whose interests were so similar to mine. I offered this stranger a few lines filled with words of comfort, but he hadn't contacted me for solace, and I soon turned to the subject at hand. Do I understand correctly that you are suggesting this because you simply want to see the story brought to light? Because you've done so much work and you don't want to see it go to nothing? I ask because I've had no experience with collaborative writing or sharing of work that has worked out well. Collaborative writing is just not something that works for me. It was mostly true. Aside from working with Hamilton McWhorter, the world's finest gentleman, to write The First Hellcat Ace, all my other attempts at collaboration had produced nothing. "I do not want to do a collaborative book," Tony replied. "I just like to give you everything I have with no strings attached, if you would consider someday to write on the Righetti topic." There it was. Tony wanted to pass his work and material to me. But the very real question remained. Tony's passion and heartbreaking situation aside, did I want to start this project? I had a passing familiarity with Righetti, but wasn't certain if there was enough of a story to justify a book. Although he had earned his commission and wings before the war, Righetti arrived late to the fighting and had missed many of the most famous battles. But after arriving in England during the fall of 1944, he threw himself into the war like a star athlete who had been kept on the bench until the final few minutes of the game. He flew and fought like a banshee and quickly became an aerial ace while also destroying more aircraft on the ground than anyone else. Sadly, despite his spectacular accomplishments, he has been largely overlooked by history, not often mentioned in the ranks of great fighter aces and leaders. This is curious, as he was awarded the Distinguished Service Cross, the second highest military honor the nation can bestow, and he shot his way to aerial acedom during a time when many men never even saw an enemy aircraft. Most impressive was his ground strafing record. Aside from a couple of dozen or more locomotives and a multitude of other important ground targets, he set the 8th Air Force record by destroying 27 German aircraft in strafing attacks. It was incredibly risky work, recognized to be more dangerous than the type of aerial combat popularly known as dogfighting. But perhaps the most noteworthy of his achievements was the spirit of professional aggressiveness he imparted to the 55th Fighter Group. After languishing in near anonymity since starting combat operations, it emerged as one of the 8th Air Force's hottest outfits. Why he faded into relative obscurity is difficult to determine with certainty. However, one reason is that the number of aerial victories he achieved did not match up with the tallies of the highest scorers. But what those lists don't take into account is that Righetti scored them when the hunting was lean. That he scored as highly as he did, 7.5 officially credited aerial victories, so late in the war is remarkable. In fact, no one during the entire history of the 55th Fighter Group knocked down more enemy aircraft while flying as part of the group. There were other reasons why his celebrity faded. Although his achievements and those of the 55th were much celebrated during the closing months of the war in Europe, the public's attention shifted to the Pacific and Japan after Germany surrendered. And once the fighting was over altogether, the nation busied itself creating a post-war society. People were weary of the war and the talk of war. But perhaps the most important reason for the gradual forgetting of his achievements was the way in which he was lost. He was alive after his aircraft was shot down during the mission of April 17, 1945, but was never heard from again. For years, no one knew if he was alive or dead. Live men can't be memorialized, and men aren't generally declared dead without substantive proof of their demise. And for its part, Righetti's family didn't beat the drum of his fame. Rather, they prayed for his safe return. As they did, the nation turned to other things. Righetti and what he accomplished gradually disappeared from America's collective memory. After much deliberation, but with all of this in mind, I decided to accept Tony's offer. To my way of thinking, the worst that could happen was that I might discover the project was not worthwhile. But even in that case, Tony's considerable archive would be saved. On the other hand, the best possible outcome, the one I obviously hoped for, was that the book would be a success and that Righetti's story would become deservedly better known. Tony was pleased by my decision and immediately started shipping his material, much of it personally annotated to me. In the meantime, we kept up a steady correspondence. His notes usually started or ended with some version of, "I'm at chemotherapy now." His body was failing, but still he worked. I was stunned at the volume of it all. Tony was obviously a collector, and the dozen or so boxes, arriving two or three at a time, quickly took over my study and garage. Even my wife, the most unflappable woman in the world, raised an eyebrow. But sympathetic to Tony's condition, she didn't say a word. During the next few months, I triaged Tony's treasure trove, which included much of the material I needed. But I knew I couldn't write the book without working with the Righetti family. Approaching them was a prickly undertaking. More than 7 decades after he left for the war, it was obvious they still missed him. Two of his sisters, Doris and Lorraine, were both in their 90s and lived not far from the ranch where they grew up with Elwyn and the rest of their siblings. The ranch was still in the family and prospering. Hard work, loyalty, and commitment are enduring Righetti traits. But where their celebrated hero Elwyn was concerned, they had been misled too many times. When I approached them, I was only the latest in a string of people who had declared they were going to preserve his legacy with a book. Most of these people were well-meaning, but few, if any, were capable of completing such a project. And none of them did. Consequently, after I contacted them, the Righettis, quite understandably, did not raise their hopes just because I promised that I was going to do what others had also promised and failed to do. And I also had been forewarned by one of the quite extensive family that the clan could be an actively opinionated bunch that didn't always agree. In other words, the Righettis were a normal family. Still, they were kind enough to meet with me. Righetti's daughter, Kyle, allowed me to copy the considerable collection of letters that were so important to the book. She additionally set up a nice lunch and arranged for a gathering that included more than a handful of relatives. After introducing my wife and myself, I explained who I was, what I wanted to do, and how I planned to approach the project. And I solicited their help. The initial circumspection and tension dissipated, and we relaxed into a nice conversation that included important recollections and an interview with Righetti's sister, Doris. The project was well and truly underway. With the family's blessing, I launched into the effort with an enthusiasm that was tempered by the promises I had made to both Tony and the Righetti family. That tempering was heightened when the notes from Tony slowed to a trickle. There finally came a message from his wife, Gina, that he had died. Tony peacefully passed away at 3:48 this morning. I was by his side. My daughters have been with me. He looks so peaceful, with a big smile. Although I had never met him, I felt sad at Tony's passing. Nevertheless, I pressed on. For reasons I still don't understand, the book developed to be the most difficult of the many I've written. My subject had perished long before, as had most of his peers. Getting the story right was consequently more difficult. And always there in various degrees was the pressure to succeed where others had not. Worse was the fact that the book wasn't immediately put on contract by the first few publishers I approached. It was a story that did not have a happy ending. Perhaps more problematic was the fact that the end might not ever be knowable. So with no immediate commitments from any of my publishing contacts, I almost panicked. I feared becoming another of those Righetti enthusiasts who had made promises they could not keep. Happily, it wasn't too long before my anxiety was salved. Casemate's managing editor, Steve Smith, recognized the story's excellent potential, and we immediately negotiated a publishing agreement. Now, with the manuscript complete, the notion that small gestures can create outsized effects has been reinforced to me. Had Tony Meldahl not reached out to me, this book would never have happened. And that would have been sad, as it is one of which I am especially proud. It is a unique story, unfiltered by its subject and untainted by modern sensibilities. Indeed, it is honestly told and preserves as much as possible the context of the world as it was more than 7 decades past. And finally, it captures the heart and essence of one of the USAAF's most complex and aggressive fighting men. He loved flying more than anything. He let go of the two teats, flexed his fingers, and sighed. Her udder dry, the cow stood stoically above him, breath steaming into the early morning cold. Across the barn, his brother Ernie finished with one Holstein and moved to another. The single leg of the milking stool strapped to his backside, wig-wagged with each step. Pop squatted nearby atop his own little stool and squeezed jets of milk into a pail, sip, sip, sip. Young Morris, wrapped in a jacket that was too big for him, scraped with a shovel at a pile of manure in the barnyard. Elwyn Guido Righetti grabbed the nearly full pail from under the cow, stood up, and rubbed his lower back. He loved his father and his brothers, and he loved his mother and his sisters, who were doing their own chores in the house beyond the barnyard. He even loved the ranch and the back-breaking work that it demanded. Nothing could compare to the way it looked and felt, or to its sounds and smells. It was home. But despite all his feelings, Righetti did not want to make his life here. Cows and fields and fences and everything else about the place, and there was plenty of everything else, were enough for his father and maybe his brothers, but not him. He wanted to go into the wider world, to do bigger and more exciting things. He needed something more. The Spanish preceded the Righettis to the Central California coast by 100 years. The golden rolling hills and the verdant valleys that characterized the area were initially visited by explorers during 1769, and Franciscan priest Junipero Serra founded the mission of San Luis Obispo soon after, on September 1, 1772. Located approximately 10 miles inland, it was the fifth of an eventual 21 missions established in California. The area's moderate Mediterranean climate featured soft, soaking winter rains and dry, bright summers. The gentle weather, together with the region's rich soils and a generally docile native population, encouraged a prosperous ranching and agricultural community. This community eventually grew into the town of San Luis Obispo. As part of Alta California, or Upper California, the region passed from Spain to Mexico at the end of the Mexican Revolution in 1821, and subsequently to the United States in 1848 following the Mexican-American War. However, its history was generally as placid as its weather, with no remarkable events or turmoil. Righetti's paternal grandfather, Francesco Robertino Righetti, arrived in the area from Switzerland in 1873. Born in 1858, he immigrated with a brother from the Italian-speaking canton of Ticino in southern Switzerland, where political discord, a series of crop failures, and a general lack of opportunity drove citizens out of the insular nation, many to California. At the time, San Luis Obispo numbered just more than 2,000 inhabitants, including a relatively large Swiss population. Like many of his countrymen, Robertino took a variety of odd jobs, including working as a hired hand on the area's dairy farms. Dairying was a way of life that many Swiss knew well. He eventually saved enough to buy a small ranch in the nearby Edna Valley, to which he added acreage over time. He built a house and married Erminia Bonetti, who bore him a son, Guido, in 1882. Three other children followed. One of them, Lorinda, died in 1891, and Erminia was taken by typhoid a few months later, that same year. Guido grew up dairying with Robertino, who eventually remarried. He attended the local public schools, where he did well enough to study at Armstrong Business College. Following several years of work in the oil industry, he returned to his roots, married Elizabeth Mary Renkert, a local girl of Swiss and French heritage, and returned to his father's ranch. This couple, as their children were born, became Mom and Pop Righetti, Elwyn's mother and father. The first child, Elizabeth, or Betty, came in 1913. "I was born in a little board and batten, mud sill, unpainted house," she said. Elwyn was born in that same house a year and a half later, on April 17, 1915. The other four children, Ernest or Ernie, Lorraine, Doris, and Morris, likewise followed in measured intervals of a year and a half. Disease was a regular danger during that time, and the Spanish flu laid Mom Righetti low during the fall of 1918. She survived but lost her sense of smell. "We always knew breakfast was ready," said Elwyn's sister Doris, "because we could smell toast burning." Polio was also a threat during this time, before an effective vaccination. Ernie, Doris, and Morris were exposed and quarantined. "I remember we talked to our parents through the hospital windows," Doris said. Ultimately, neither she nor Morris exhibited any symptoms. Ernie was not so lucky. "They put sandbags on my legs to keep them straight," he said. "That was all they could do." It wasn't enough, and Ernie walked with a slight limp for the remainder of his life. On the other hand, unlike thousands of children, Ernie survived. And, likely to the relief of Mom and Pop, the mild disability exempted him from military service later, during World War II. But notwithstanding polio and other childhood diseases, ranching and farming were dangerous in their own right. They always had been. A kick from a horse could kill in an instant. Lightning struck men down in the blink of an eye. Razor-sharp tools slashed or punctured or took fingers and hands in accidents. And during this time when powered machinery was only just becoming commonplace on the farm, unguarded belts and gears and chains, combined with ignorance or carelessness or plain bad luck, tore away scalps, ripped off arms, and pulled men into their mechanicals where they were ground to death. In fact, long before Elwyn was born, his father Guido was so badly injured that he nearly died. An account was carried by the local newspaper. Yesterday morning, Guido Righetti, the 15-year-old son of Robertino Righetti of Edna, was brought to this city and placed in the care of doctors Nichols and Dial at the Grutley Hotel. The little fellow had started out to ride a horse on his father's ranch, minus a bridle, and relying solely upon a rope which he placed about the horse's nose. He allowed the rope to become slack, and the animal stumbled, throwing the boy heavily to the ground. Injuries were sustained about the left side of the head and upon the left shoulder. The boy remained insensible for fully an hour after being picked up by his father. Ultimately, the family patriarch was lost to an accident. On September 6, 1929, Robertino, who had come to the area from Switzerland more than five decades earlier, felled a tree on his ranch. As he trimmed the limbs, it rolled over, pinned him to the ground, broke his back, and killed him. Still, those sorts of dangers existed on nearly every farm and ranch across the country. The truth was that there were few places better suited for ranching and dairying than the area around San Luis Obispo. Although nature was occasionally stingy with rain, the temperatures were idyllic. The region's settlers were never forced to endure the bone-numbing cold that blanketed much of the nation during the winter, nor did they suffer from the sopping, stinking heat that stifled the Midwest, the South, and much of the East during the summer. Indeed, the rural upbringing of the Righetti children was almost a Rockwellian cartoon. "Oh, it was a good life," said Doris. "There was lots of love in the family, and everyone did their part. Pop was the disciplinarian, and Mom looked after us. If we did something to get Pop mad, Mom would always step in and say, 'Oh, go easy, that's not so bad,' or 'Don't get mad, they didn't mean for it to go wrong.' So our parents were well-balanced." "Sometimes the neighbors seemed too far away," said Doris, "and then there were times when they seemed too close. Our parents played cards with other parents in the area, and that's how we got to know a lot of the other kids." Doris noted that the Righetti children occasionally picked up bad habits from their neighbors, and I'm sure we passed some of our own on to them. "We were almost two sets of kids," Doris said. "The oldest, Elizabeth, Elwyn, and Ernie ran together, while Lorraine and Morris and I did what we did together." The Righetti children varied in their temperaments. Elizabeth, the oldest, was smart, strong-willed, and self-sufficient. The others paid attention when she spoke. "Elwyn was always the adventurous one," said Doris. "He loved to be outside, and he loved to hunt. Sometimes he didn't like working on the ranch too much. And Ernie was serious and reliable and a very hard worker. He and Elwyn were very close, and Ernie really looked up to him." The girls did most of their chores inside the house. Among Elizabeth's jobs was washing the dishes and cleaning kerosene lamps. Electrical service didn't reach the house until 1941. I washed those old lamp chimneys because they would get sooty and not shed any light. Immediately after high school, Elizabeth went to work in a dentist's office. I wore white uniforms, but we had to heat the irons on the old stove, and if you got even a speck of soot from the stove onto the iron, it would streak the uniform. My mom and I cried over those uniforms sometimes. The other girls and I loved horses, said Doris. In the evening, when it came time to bring in the cows, we raced the boys to the horses. The first ones there got to ride, and we usually beat them. And Morris, the youngest, was at the tail end, she said. He was so sweet. He didn't like hunting as much as Elwyn and Ernie. A good part of the family's income came from the dairy cows, about 20 head of Holsteins, that demanded near-constant attention. Dairying was a never-ending job, and it was mostly done by Pop and the boys. The cows required milking twice each day, and everything that came into contact with the milk required fastidious cleaning or sterilization. The milk was put into pans on racks, said Elizabeth, and they would let the cream rise and skim it off. Then they put the milk into cans that were furnished by the creamery and take it down to San Luis Obispo. From there it was sent via railroad to Avila and then transshipped to San Francisco. Another source of income was the herd of beef cattle, and sometimes sheep, that the family raised on the ranch's pasture land. By the 1930s, the ranch had grown to more than 1,000 acres with fences that needed regular repair. The boys became experts with barbed wire and cutters and posthole diggers. Although not so needy as the dairy cows, the other animals still had to be watched and cared for, as there was seldom a time when one or more of them was not sick or lame or otherwise needful of attention. Both the girls and the boys regularly canvassed the ranch on horseback and reported to their father. He believed the livestock needed to be counted often, recalled Elizabeth. It was important to know where they were and how they were doing. Then there was the hay and grain, barley, wheat, oats, and corn, that supplemented the grass in the pastures. In helping to tend these crops, the children learned not only how to operate such varied machinery as tractors, spreaders, binders, and balers, but they also grew savvy about how to maintain and repair them. Later, during World War II, instructors in the technical disciplines were surprised to discover that America's country bumpkins were more mechanically astute than their supposedly sophisticated city cousins. The family bought some foodstuffs from stores in town, but much of what they ate was produced on the ranch. Mom baked all the bread, said Doris, and she had Rhode Island red chickens for eggs and for the table, and there were hogs, Poland China hogs. I disliked them. They were huge and they smelled bad and were mean and nasty. It was my job to slop them. Cows and pigs were occasionally butchered, and their hides were scalded in a massive steel kettle near the barn. Canned and dried vegetables from the household garden and fruit from various trees supplemented the family's fare. There was always a big pot of pink beans on the stove, Doris said. They were just lightly seasoned and always there for anyone whenever they wanted. Next to them, there was always a pot of applesauce. The two were always just there together, always a part of our lives. Aside from hard work, the ranch was a place that rewarded, even demanded, teamwork, well-considered and timely decisions, and good, plain common sense. As he grew, Elwyn came to understand all of this and more, even if he didn't always practice it. As a young man, he often wished to be elsewhere. Sometimes, Doris allowed, Elwyn tried not to work too hard. Still, he learned not only how to work with and around machinery, but also with beasts, crops, and especially people. And the work made him strong. It suited a body that was muscled and lean, but still big enough to shoulder heavy loads. Ultimately, the value of the family's hard work was apparent to him everywhere. It was on the dinner table, it was in the bank account, it was in the neat fences that crisscrossed the property, and in the barn, corral, and silo. And most important, it was apparent in his father's smile, a smile that signified approval of a job well done. "Elwyn was my hero," said Elizabeth. "He and I started grammar school together and walked all the way from the home place down to the Independence Grammar School, just more than a mile. It was a one-room school with an anteroom for the boys and a separate one for the girls. The boys came in the south side and the girls entered on the north side. We left our hats and coats and lunches in the anterooms and had class in the big room. Elwyn and I sat in the same seat for a while, and then the teacher, Amelia Lewis, sat us with older children so they could help teach us. Mom and Pop emphasized the importance of schoolwork and education. Mrs. Lewis was a disciplinarian," said Elizabeth, "and my dad used to say that if we got a licking at school and he heard about it, then we were going to get another licking when we got home. Dad believed in school. He went to school to learn and not to fool around. I think he whopped the boys with a razor strop once or twice." There were rarely more than 20 students at any one time, and both Elizabeth and Elwyn excelled through good instruction, familial support, and their own innate intelligence. They also, as did all their siblings, became active participants in 4-H, which sought to better connect public school learning with rural lifestyles and skills. When they came of age, a bus took them to San Luis Obispo High School, where Elwyn performed well ahead of his peers. In fact, he graduated with Elizabeth in 1931, when he was just 16. "And then he found girls," said Doris. "He wasn't around nearly as much after that, unless he had to be. It is likely that there were plenty of girls only too willing to be found. Elwyn was good-looking. He had an even-featured face, straight white teeth, a thick shock of brown hair, and an athletic build. He was smart and charming and came from a respectable family that operated a fair-sized ranch. Photos from the period show a smiling young man who carried himself with grace and confidence. On the other hand, he was inexperienced, was not regularly employed, and owned nothing. And the early 1930s were the worst years of the Great Depression. Steady jobs were difficult to find and hold, especially for a boy still in his teens. Although Mom and Pop fed and clothed him and put a roof over his head, he and Ernie received little else. I never did draw a salary," said Ernie. Exacerbating the employment realities were Steinbeck's Okies, displaced farmers from Oklahoma and elsewhere who flooded California in search of a better life. They hunkered down in squalid camps and followed the truck crop harvests, working as pickers and packers. In fact, famed photographer Dorothea Lange's iconic photo, Migrant Mother, was captured only 10 miles south of the ranch, near Napomo. It showed a woman seemingly devoid of hope, a small child clinging to her shoulder. Certainly the plight of these people affected Elwyn and the rest of the family. However, except for drops in dairy and beef prices, the Great Depression had no significant impact on the day-to-day lives of the family. "We just went on as we always had," Doris said. "We had always been land rich and dollar poor." In fact, Mom and Dad were frugal by nature, and the family's income before and after the crash was typically spent on improvements or to buy more land to enlarge the ranch. Clothes and shoes were handed down or altered or mended rather than thrown out. "Mom had a friend in San Francisco who used to send down clothes she didn't wear anymore," said Elizabeth. "Some of our clothes came from her. Likewise, equipment was repaired until it simply gave out. Consequently, the collapse of the nation's economy and the government's reactionary machinations in faraway Washington, D.C. made little difference to the Righettis." "We still had pink beans and applesauce," said Doris. "You can do a lot with pink beans." "And ammunition. There was always plenty of ammunition for target practice, plinking pests, and hunting." "Elwyn loved to hunt," said Doris. "He loved to hunt about as much as anything else. Indeed, whenever possible, Elwyn and Ernie disappeared into the scrub and oaks of the surrounding canyons to hunt whatever counted as food, rabbits, ducks, dove, and quail, and especially deer. Their hunting was always done legally and always in season," Doris said. "Well, maybe not always. The deer indigenous to the area were blacktails, closely related to mule deer. They seldom exceeded 200 pounds, but were a welcome addition to the dinner table. Elwyn grew up to be an exceptional shot with both rifle and shotgun. He especially looked forward to the hunting trips that Pop arranged to Northern California and Idaho for mule deer and elk. Pop and the boys packed a truck and trailer with camping gear, rifles, food, and a pack horse, and then drove a day or more to favorite hunting areas. Dad used a 25-35 Winchester Model 94, said Ernie, and Elwyn had a 32 Winchester Special Model 94. When Elwyn enrolled in the California Polytechnic College in San Luis Obispo in 1933, he likely did so as much out of boredom as for any other reason. Since graduating from high school, he had done little more than work on the ranch. His early graduation had served him no real purpose. Although he still lived at home, college exposed him to something other than the sameness that had been his life to that point. Moreover, he met new people. Oh, he loved school, said Doris. He made a lot of friends and became very involved in a lot of activities. Doris did not exaggerate. The school's annual, El Rodeo, showed that Elwyn, whose course of study was meat animals, was a member of the Future Farmers of America, the Boots and Spurs Club, and the manager of the El Rodeo itself. Moreover, he was made a member of Gamma Pi Delta, a fraternity that emphasized service and leadership. Aside from their stated charters, the highlight of service with these clubs was the social activities, dances, barbecues, beach parties, and other events. In fact, he was made the king of Poly Royal, the annual festival that became the hallmark of the school's social calendar. He was so handsome, said Doris. Elwyn's course of study lasted 2 years, and he scored good grades, graduating in 1935. But still, the nation was in the grips of the Great Depression, and employment was difficult. He found work during the next couple of years driving trucks and working as a salesman for both Swift Creamery and Golden State Creamery. It did not satisfy his ambitions. He came home one day after smashing his hand working on a truck, said Doris. He told me that there had to be a better way to make a living. He also tried retail sales in town and additionally went to work for a Buick dealer. There, the owner was unable to collect payments against a considerable list of customers. Elwyn established an arrangement whereby he kept half of any defunct debt he was able to collect. Exercising considerable charm and persuasiveness, he laid out realistic payment plans for the delinquent parties. These were people he knew or knew of, and he enjoyed a good deal of success. Noting that success and the methods that made it possible, the owner took Elwyn's plan as his own and relegated him to the lot as a used car salesman. Tragedy, masquerading as opportunity, came to the Central California coast when the Norwegian lumber freighter Elg ran aground at Oceano near San Luis Obispo on September 9, 1938. When the rising tide failed to lift the ship free, the captain ordered its cargo jettisoned. That cargo was nearly 500,000 linear feet of finely milled Canadian lumber. During the next few days, as tugs worked to free the ship, and as the lumber was dumped into the ocean, the surrounding area was swept by a gold rush mentality. Virtually every able-bodied man went down to the cold, choppy water to claim what he could under the law of salvage. The San Luis Obispo Daily Telegram recorded the scene. Trucks, trailers, and tractors arrived from points as far away as Paso Robles and Santa Maria to carry away loads of lumber varying from a few hundreds of board feet to thousands of board feet. Stories circulated regarding men being hired by contractors at $1 and even $1.50 an hour to salvage the lumber as it washed ashore. A line of trucks stretched nearly a mile, waiting to gain access to the beach. Opportunism and greed were everywhere. One man set his daughter up in the back of his truck to sell hot dogs to famished salvagers. Disputes over ownership of the errant rafts of boards were common, and shoving matches and fistfights broke out. Weary watchers who had stood by piles of lumber along more than a mile of beach through Sunday night, waiting for trucks to arrive, had difficulties galore. A man, red-eyed from sleeplessness, said he had left his wife to watch his salvaged lumber while he left to find food, and on his return, his wife weepingly reported that strangers with a truck had pushed her aside and taken the lumber. The sheriff and his deputies were able to do little more than try to control the chaos. The salvaging was dangerous, and many of the men had no business being in the frigid.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.